Okay, so now let me go ahead and talk about what's called the Coase Theorem. And Ronald Coase is, at least among economists, at least very famous. And he actually just died a couple of weeks ago. So lived a very long and productive life. So the Coase Theorem is the idea that if there are externalities, then people may be able to bargain their way to the efficient outcome. And I'm going to go ahead and make a little example here, which I think will illustrate both some of the potential and some of the potential shortfalls of the Coase Theorem. So let's suppose we have some dam out there. So got some dam, it's sitting here, and there's a whole bunch of water here. And normally, of course, it lets out a little bit of water. And maybe there's a fish ladder or something like that, but the dam does two things. One is it generates electricity. And we'll go ahead and call the value or the profit from generating that much electricity D dollars here. But let's also say that it has a negative effect on fishermen. And it lowers their profits by F dollars. So, some questions here. How does the relative size of F versus D impact the efficiency of keeping the dam versus destroying it? How do people's property rights about either keeping their dam or having a property right to have this fishery be free impact the efficiency of the eventual outcome, and how does the distribution of those property rights affect the distribution of economic welfare? So, let's go ahead and think about some different scenarios. What I'm going to call scenario one is going to be the owners of the dam have the right to control whether it exists or not. And I'm also going to assume that in this case, the value of the fish is greater than the value of the dam. Scenario two is going to be the fishermen have the right to have dam removed. And I'm going to keep on assuming here that the fish are worth more than the dam. So, the way we think this might play out is that in scenario one, the fishermen can offer the dam owners some money to tear down their dam. So the fishermen offer P dollars to dam owners. Because since the dam owners have the right, the fishermen have to actually compensate them or persuade them to tear down the dam. And a price that is between the value of the fish and the value of the dam will be mutually beneficial, because the fishermen will then have gains of F minus P, whereas before they would get nothing, or they would suffer the harms of F. So fishermen are better off, and the dam builders get paid price P, but they lose out on profits D, so they end up ahead. So the outcome is that the dam is destroyed. Okay. What about this scenario two here? The fishermen have the right to have the dam removed. Well, in this case, they just remove the dam. They, you know, sue the dam owners and say, hey, get rid of that dam. And the economic welfare of the fishermen is F, and the economic welfare of the dam owners is nada. But the outcome is the same. The dam is removed. So what we can see here is that who owns the dam does not affect whether or not we get to that outcome of the dam being destroyed. And given that F is greater than D, given that the fish are worth more than the dam being destroyed is the efficient thing to do. What happens, though, is that the allocation of these property rights does change the level of economic welfare. In particular, it means that the dam owners have to be compensated if they have the rights, or they don't have to be compensated if they don't have the rights. Or, the other way of looking at it, the fishermen are worse off if they actually have to pay someone than if they don't. So there's actually going to be two other scenarios here. So scenario three, the dam owners have rights. And now we're going to reverse the situation as far as which is more valuable. Now we're going to say the dam's profits are greater than the fishermen's harms associated with those profits. Scenario four is going to be the fishers have rights. But again, the value, the profits of the dam's electricity are greater than the profits associated, or the harm to profits associated with the fish. So in this case, if the owners have rights, and if F is less than D, then there's no price that the fishers are going to be able to pay the dam owners that is going to compensate the dam owners for their loss of profits. So in this case, the dam stays, and the fishermen get zero economic welfare, and the dam owners get D. If, on the other hand, the fishers have rights, and the dam is more profitable, keeping the dam is more profitable than tearing it down, then the dam owners pay fishers to not exercise their rights. So they have some out-of-court settlement or something like that. And the price that they're going to pay is, again, going to have to lie between those two numbers. I think I might have reversed the inequalities here. No, that works too. I could have also said it this way. Whichever way makes more sense to you. So the distribution of economic welfare in this case is that the fishermen get paid that price P, and the dam owners get their profits minus what they paid to the fishermen. But the outcome is the same, that in this case, in both of these cases, it's efficient to keep the dam because the dam is contributing more profits to dam owners than it is to fishermen, and so in both of these cases the dam stays. So one result of the Coase theorem is that the allocation of property rights or decision-making rights affects economic welfare. Because essentially, if you have rights, either you don't have to pay to exercise them, or if it's more efficient that you not exercise them, you can at least get some compensation for giving up your rights. But it doesn't, the allocation of property rights doesn't affect whether we get to the efficient outcome. Okay. Now, all that said, there are some complications. There's almost always some complications. And so what we're going to see here is that we have a couple of problems here. Almost all of these can be lumped under the idea of what we call transactions costs. So in particular, in my last example, I assumed that we had two monolithic groups. But in fact, we may have divided or dispersed groups. And that may make it tough to get all the fishermen on the same page, because if I'm a fisherman and I pay towards getting the dam torn down, well, is it going to be possible for you to just sort of free ride off that and not contribute towards that? And if I know that you're not going to contribute to the dam being torn down, well, maybe I'll take it back. Maybe I won't contribute. So both forming an agreement and enforcing an agreement become much harder when we have larger groups. So it might be that the dam owners are all one monolithic group of decision makers, but the fishermen almost certainly aren't. Often there's going to be just simple bargaining costs. Coming to a decision and an arrangement on who compensates who and under what conditions and so on and so forth takes a long time. And my example is all sort of drawn from the recent stuff to do with the Klamath River, and it's taken years and years and years and millions of dollars of lawyers' fees to actually get all that sorted out. Because essentially people are bargaining and negotiating over the division of the gains. You know, it was fairly clear that having the dam torn down was the economically efficient thing to do, but allocating who pays what portion of the costs and who gets what portion of the benefits, that took a very long time. So because of these two things, the Coase Theorem, it can apply in some situations, but often it won't apply, because the costs of reaching a transaction are simply going to be too big. But if it's a one-on-one situation, you know, there's a good chance that you and the roommates can come to some situation where you negotiate who cleans up what portion of the mess and so on and so forth.